tasted, I've seen, and nothing comes close. I've never known a love like yours. Jesus, your name is power. It's breath and living water. And your spirit guides me to the heart of the Father. Let your praise ring louder every day and every hour. 'Cause your spirit guides me to the heart of the Father. I've never felt at home like this. Just like a child, so innocent. And I'm safe inside your arms, 'cause you won't let go. I've never known a love like yours, no. Jesus, your name is power. It's breath and living water. In your spirit guides me to the heart. God, we sing praise. God, we sing praise. We sing praise. We sing praise. We
Good morning, friends. Good morning. You don't mind finding a seat? Want to welcome you to our service today. Cannot believe it's Palm Sunday already. The year is flying, isn't it? Welcome to those who are joining us from home. We're glad you're part of the service with us. Couple quick things as we start our time together. There is no Sunday school next week in honor of Resurrection Sunday, so be here about 10:15. We'll have our normal service time of 10:30 starting for Resurrection Sunday. And just to put in the back of your head, I have been asked about a sunrise service. Didn't get it put together for this year, but just as a kind of teaser from it for next year. let's see. Job fair. Gail, why don't you speak to that, please?
Yeah, so we are really excited. Job fair is April 25th. I'm already full at the first floor of the armory, so I've gotten permission to use the second floor if we have some more vendors. And the early bird isn't even up until like Wednesday, so really excited about that. There is a sign up in the narthex, there's an extensive list of ways you can help. So if you would check that out and see where the Lord would have you plug in, that would be great. Thanks. Great.
Egg hunt, you want to mention that? Egg hunt?
Yeah, we're having an Easter egg hunt over at Hoosick Meadows on Saturday. So if anyone would like to help with that, you're welcome to. You can see Polly or Casey's not here. See Polly.
Great. All right, Passover, in terms of the Levitical holiday from Leviticus 23, begins Wednesday. And we have at times done it in large group setting, but biblically it was to be done house by house, family by family. So we're not doing a big Seder this year, but if you are interested in doing one, I'd be happy to kind of coach you through that in terms of the Haggadahs that we use and the menus, the recipes. So you're welcome to see me or Gwen Fair after the service with regard to that. All right, birthdays and anniversaries.
Good morning. So April was a really popular month for birthdays and anniversaries. So we'll start with Bill Tudor, who's tomorrow. What? Diane Phippen. Sue Donovan is Dan Smith. Scott Hodges. Stephen McKenzie. Anniversary for the Robichauds and the Mackins on the 12th and 13th. The 15th of April, Alexis Mayer, Ken White, Colette Arnold, Elijah Petrovsky, sorry about that, Savannah Phippen, Robin White, Suzanne Baker, Bruce Boyer, Camden Hahn, Judah Swanson, and I guess that's the end of the month. So, happy birthday.
Yeah.
Lead us off.
Yeah, so let's sing. We say birthday, but for those anniversary folk, we're celebrating you too, okay? A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you, every day of the year, may you find Jesus near. A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you, and the best you've ever had. There we go.
So the other announcement I would like to make is on Monday, the 3rd, is our quarterly blood drive. So there are still slots open. The app on your phone is blood.org. It's very easy to sign up. We always need people to donate. It's very quick, and the staff generally is wonderful. So hopefully we'll see some people from the church there.
With regard to the blood drive, immediately following the service, we need to stack the chairs and get them to the sides. So for those who are able to help with that, we really appreciate your assistance. It just clears the space for the Red Cross folk to come in tomorrow morning and get set up. We appreciate that. Yes, yeah.
Grief share will take place tomorrow night.
Even though the blood drive, they'll be cleaning up, we'll just meet in the rooms across the way.
Great. Grief share is still on for tomorrow. Okay. Great. Any other announcements for the good of the order? Yes, Gwen Fair.
There's a VBS video.
VBS video. Thank you for reminding me of that. VBS video.
Remember about the Bible story of Daniel? Then it's time you got the rest of the story.
It's a good thing that, hey, yeah, you owe me a prayer.
So exciting to think about. It's usually our largest outreach of the year, and it really does touch the community. You might remember dear friends who were part of this congregation for a long time, Bill and Joanne Brown. Bill was pretty instrumental in making this place look just incredible for VBS. Every year, so faithful, putting hours of work in. I don't think he's going to make it up here to help us this year. We could ask. That's a good idea. We could ask. Bill, as you're watching, I know they sometimes watch. We miss you. But I'm just saying that in terms of who will take up the baton from Bill and who will help in terms of making this place look great for the kids' sake. And it's impactful when they come in and they see the sanctuary just like decked out. So give consideration, prayerful consideration to that, friends. And you can speak with Cheryl Workman in the weeks ahead in terms of letting her know your willingness to help. There's lots of ways to plug into that. So you can speak with her or speak with me later. All right, let's just bow our heads for a brief moment, quiet our hearts, and prepare ourselves for our service today. Some of us are wearing purple. Yes, Jim.
Men's breakfast canceled
in light of Resurrection Sunday the next day, but we are on for May and looking forward to that. So be aware. A couple deep breaths. Prepare your heart for the worship of the King. Some of us are wearing purple. It's in the ancient world, kind of an understanding that's a color of royalty. And Jesus came in to the acclaim of the crowds on Palm Sunday because he was born, what? King of the Jews. Jesus was born king. He is king. He will always be king. Prepare your hearts, friends, to worship the King.
You could stand with us this morning, please.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, as we raise our praise to you, we lift our eyes to you, Jesus. Lord. We turn to you, Jesus.
Bless
you. Our hearts are stirring and longing for you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Bless this time, Lord. Amen.
Worthy of all our praises, Hosanna.
Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world. Jesus Messiah.
Thank you.
Rising up to take their place.
I'm in awe of you.
bow our hearts before you. God, we bend our will to yours. Be glorified, God, in our midst. Make your presence wonderfully known here today. God, would you touch and transform lives all through this sanctuary. Father, I think of the Phippens who may even at these moments be arriving in New York City for their flight. God, would you bless them with travel mercies today. May they sense your everlasting arms beneath them, carrying them through this long journey. God, anoint their lives as they serve you in Malawi. Father, for us here, anoint our lives for service right here in this village. God, give us eyes to see, ears to hear, hearts that are quick to obey as we turn to your word today. Lord, I pray for the children's devotion as Lisa comes and shares, Lord, that not only the children, but all of us, Lord, would be attentive to what you have for us in these sacred moments together. We love you, God. We praise you. We say, Hosanna, King. We worship you, Lord. Thank you, Father, for such a Savior in Jesus. In his name we give you praise. Amen. Friends, be seated, please. Children, you can come forward now. Lisa's going to share. Anybody, does this key fob and leather, there we go. Give your attention, please, up front here. Children of all ages.
Okay. Good morning. I know some of you had a Sunday school lesson this morning about what today is, and some of you didn't. But we are going to talk about what today is in a special way. How many of you have either been to a parade or have participated in a parade? Okay, so everybody has either been to a parade or has participated. I think of the Memorial Day parade. Lots of times I see children and adults, but usually children with these flags, and they're waving them as the parade happens. Would you like to hold that carefully while we're doing this? Thank you. And it's a parade. Why do we have parades? Does anyone know why? Why? Okay, to celebrate, to honor. For Memorial Day, it's an honoring of veterans who have served. And then sometimes there's one person that's called a Grand Marshal. Hi, have a seat. A Grand Marshal that's in a car and that is waving and is like a veteran. And they're being honored and representative of all the veterans that are being honored. Well, today we celebrate a praise parade that happened a long time ago with Jesus, and we can be praising and we can have parades and worship like we just did. We sang a lot of Hosanna, which they did at the parade at that time, in Jesus' time. And he was the only person in the parade. Well, he and a donkey. We go. So there was he, a donkey, and then the people, instead of waving flags, they ripped off palm branches. And I am sure that not one of the children had a palm branch fight. They were so excited at who the parade was about that they were waving and putting them down in honor of Jesus. Okay. So we have a verse from the scripture that tells about this praise parade that happened when Jesus came riding on a donkey. And he rode on a donkey because a donkey was not a war horse. It was a humble animal, and it was borrowed. It was a boy, young donkey, a colt, would have been a male young donkey, hadn't ever been ridden on. I kind of put this donkey's hair down. He should have had it up a little bit more for his due, but it would have gotten into my word. But when you color, if you want to put his due up, that's more like a donkey. So there was a donkey, and the people on both sides of this parade had cloaks. I'm going to put this around Mr. Bruce. He's such a good helper. They had cloaks on, and some of them, it would have been the men, the males, okay, and not children or the women would have had these. They would have had cloaks like this, and they would have had these on each corner. Okay, and this is called a tallit, and this is a male prayer shawl. And these fringes and this particular thing is called a tzitzi. It's a hard word to say, tzitzi. Okay, tzitzi, tzitzi. And these would remind God's people of his commandments. This on the corner says, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And so, in the Jesus parade, as he would have been coming on this donkey, the people would have been laying down their tallits. And the children and the other people that had ripped palm branches off because the trees were there, this was to honor and to celebrate. And I'm sure none of them were having sword fights with each other. They were so excited about the king that they would have been praising and waving. And as he came, they would have been putting them down for the donkey and he to ride on as part of the praise parade. The King of Kings and Lord of Lords, to lay this down, if you were a Jewish male, would have been acknowledging that the one who rode on the humble donkey and came in peace to the city and riding in was the Messiah, was the King of Kings, was the Lord of Lords, and that would have been quite a thing for them to have done. Such so that some of the teachers, the religious teachers of the day, said to Jesus, you need to stop them from doing this, because what they were doing was that they were shouting, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And some would have been singing, and they kept shouting it. If you're at a parade, sometimes people will call out different things, and that would have been this joyful celebration of Jesus coming in, waving palm branches like we wave flags at our parades. And so we have a song. Mr. Bruce and I are going to sing with you, and maybe some of the people out there also know this song. And it's called King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and it's a lively chorus, and we're going to clap, okay? You ready, Mr. Bruce, and anybody else who knows this? Okay, it goes like this. King of Kings and Lord of Lords, glory, hallelujah. King of Kings and Lord of Lords, glory, hallelujah. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, hallelujah. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, hallelujah. Now, if we had more time, we would do that faster, but we're not going to do that right now. Oh, one other thing. When those grumpy religious teachers told him to stop, he said, if they don't do it, the rocks would cry out. Now, I have never heard a stone speak or sing, but Jesus was saying the impossible would happen if people didn't praise him, that the very stones would cry out if people didn't use their voices in praise of him. And so this is a day of celebrating and remembering that triumphal entry of Jesus. And later, you will get these, and I know Emma's not here today. Mr. Rob Allen knows how to fold these into a cross. And probably, Emma, you know how to do that? Do you know how to do that? Maybe your brother does. Some of you know. You don't know how to, your dad does this? You can fold it and make a cross out of these. All right. Let's pray together. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And we praise you for that. Hosanna, save now. That was another thing that was said about you, and we sang, and we are so grateful for your saving grace. Thank you for each child here. May you bless each one with a saving knowledge of you. May they grow in you. May you bless their families in every way. Help us, Lord, to offer to you the praise that is worthy of you, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen. There are color sheets over there. Thank you for that.
If you folks want to turn to page 878 in the Pew Bibles or find the Gospel of Luke in your own scriptures. Any historians know who this local icon is?
Finney?
No, it's not Finney. Good guess. Any guesses now? Samuel Wilson. Samuel Wilson was a meat packer from Troy, New York. And he supplied rations for our troops in the War of 1812. And the boxes that they went in were stamped with EA for the distributor and then US. And the soldiers always said, well, that stood for Uncle Sam. And so Uncle Sam became a name associated with the U.S. government, the figure of Columbia as a personification of the people of the U.S., Uncle Sam became a personification of the government of the U.S. And J.M. Flagg did this recruiting poster for 1917 as World War I was approaching and they were gathering an army to fight the forces of evil, and this famous cartoon picture was called Uncle Sam. So that's as local as Troy. You can go down to the big cemetery, probably the biggest cemetery I've ever been in. Did Anne Marie Ferguson, for those of you who remember Anne Marie, she's buried down there in the same cemetery that Uncle Sam Wilson was buried in. You just drive and drive and drive. It's huge. But you can find Uncle Sam's grave. It's marked there. So Uncle Sam was saying, I want you to serve. And today, as we turn to scriptures, it's my conviction that Jesus is saying that to us today. So you're welcome to remain seated as I read scripture, but let's look at Luke 19. I'll read from 28 to 40. And when he said these things, he went ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he drew near to Bethpage and Bethany at the mount that is called Olivet, he sent two of the disciples, saying, go into the village in front of you, where on entering you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever yet sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you untying it? You should say this, the Lord has need of it. So those who were sent away went away and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owner said to them, why are you untying the colt? And they said, the Lord has need of it. And they brought it to Jesus, and throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. And as he rode along, they spread their cloaks on the ground. As he was drawing near, already on the way down the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out." Amen. Father, would you bless your word in our lives as we study it today? So today is Palm Sunday, and we commemorate this triumphal entry of Jesus at the beginning of the week of his passion. Last week, we were thinking about the passion of Jesus. We thought about his death on the cross and what caused his death, and my conviction that it was the pain of a broken heart when the Father turned his face away for the first time in all eternity from the Son, and that broke Jesus's heart, my conviction. Study the scriptures and come to your own conclusion. But today we move forward in a sense in terms of the chronology of the week that Jesus is coming into Jerusalem. He tells his disciples to go ahead of him and find a colt to be used. And he prompts them, he prepares them in case someone questions their actions. He says, respond to whoever it may be by saying, "The Lord has need of it." The Greek word here in terms of Lord is kyrios. And Thayer's lexicon says, in terms of defining the word, he to whom a person or thing belongs, about which he has the power of deciding, master, Lord, used almost universally of the possessor and disposer of a thing, the owner. Now, I don't know about you, but I use Lord as a term in my prayers a lot. I speak to Lord Jesus. I ask and intercede about things to the Lord Jesus. Do anybody else out there use Lord? Lord is a common title we use for Christ. It's used, I didn't look it up, but it's used hundreds of times in the New Testament of Christ. So it's a great, great word. And friends, I want you to think as you move forward now in terms of using the term Lord, think about Thayer's definition. Again, let's look at it. He to whom a person or thing belongs. Friend, do you understand that you belong to Jesus? That Jesus has purchased you from the enemy back to God. He's purchased you to the Father. Okay? How did he do that? Last week we studied the Passion. He poured out his life's blood for you. He suffered incredible agony on your behalf to pay the penalty for your sin. And at the end, as he's on the cross again, he said, "Tetelestai, it is finished, it's complete, it's paid in full. You've been bought and paid for." So when you pray and you use the term Lord Jesus, I want you to think about the fact that you belong to Christ, right? He has the power of deciding. Are you the boss of your life? No, you're not. Okay? Do you get to decide where you go and what you do? No. If you've given your heart to Jesus, you belong to him. He has the power, he has the position of authority over your life. You are not your own, friend. You belong to Jesus. Okay? He has the power of decision making. Friends, I think so often, when we have elder meetings or governance authority meetings, board meetings, I think often of an empty chair in whatever room. We typically, in terms of elder meetings, meet in my office, and board meetings, we meet in the conference room. I think of an empty chair as we begin our meetings. And I think about Jesus filling that chair. I think about it. It's cognizant. It's heavy on my heart and mind. Jesus, would you be present to be head of the church? I pray it. I talk about it. It is not mere lip service for me, friends. It is a deep, deep heart conviction that I desperately want Jesus to be head of the church. I don't want to be the mover and shaker here, friends. I don't want someone else to be the mover and shaker here. I want Jesus to be Lord over our fellowship. Desperate desire on my part. I want to get out of the way. Jesus, would you come to the fore? Would you be decision maker? When we talk and pray as elders, would you be decision maker? When we talk and pray as a board, how do we spend money? What do we do? How do we do it? Jesus, would you be head of the church? He is Lord. Amen? He's Lord. He is decision maker, not me, not you, not someone else. Jesus is Lord. Possessor and disposer of a thing. Think about that as you pray and you speak to the Lord Jesus. Lord, you are the disposer of me. Do with me as you will. Tell me where to go and what to do and how to do it. Think about this incredible word used again and again in the scriptures to reference Jesus' place, his title, his position. He is Lord. Again, the Talit has on it what? King of kings and Lord of lords. Of all the lords out there, he is the topmost, the preeminent. And he told the disciples, say, the Lord has need of it. Okay? It's a necessity, it's a need, it's a duty, it's business. The Lord has need of it. And again, we want to think about this personally. How does this impact us? And at the end of the passage, when again, the religious leaders of Jesus' day. Let's not ruffle feathers here. We don't want Rome to get upset. Hey, we got to keep them happy. The overlords, they're nasty folk, these Gentile. Jesus has none of that, friends. He says, if my followers will be silent, the rocks and stones themselves will cry out. Now, for me, I want a purpose in my heart. I'm not going to let someone or something do my job. Are you with me, friends? I'm not going to let someone or something do what I'm supposed to be doing. Okay? Jesus is coming back soon, I believe, and I want to be found faithful doing what I'm supposed to be doing. I've joked about the bumper sticker I saw as a young man. Jesus is coming back. Look busy. I don't want to look busy. I want to be busy about kingdom work. So I'm not going to let stones cry out what I'm supposed to be the one crying out. Okay? So we need to determine in our hearts to become people of praise. Do we praise just when the times are good? No. We praise no matter what the circumstance may be. Because the circumstance can change around us, but Jesus never changes. Amen? He is the same what? Yesterday, today, and? Yeah, forever. Jesus is the same. He doesn't change. He is always worthy of praise. Did he die and pay the penalty for your sins, friends? Is that done and taken care of in the past? It is. It's accomplished. Again, he said on the cross, it's paid in full. Done deal. 3 days later, he rises to prove it's finished forever and always. That never changes. In good times, in bad times, he is still Lord of all. So he's worthy of our praise. So how do we praise? I want to think in context of this passage and what it says about what the people did on that eventful day so long ago. Scripture says a whole lot about how to praise. There's lots of places we can go to, but just in Luke 19, let's think about this, okay? It says that they were crying out, "Blessed is the King." Again, this is rulership. This is a place of authority in our lives. So part of our worship is confessing the rule of Jesus in our lives. Father, you are a God above all, and we praise you, we worship you, we magnify your holy name. That's part of praise, is confessing with our lips. We tell the world as we do so, guess what? We tell ourselves, right? The words come out of our mouths and it bounces back into our ears, and the tympanic membrane vibrates, and the hammer and the stirrup and all that stuff in the inner ear, and it sends the signals to the brain. And as I speak, "Jesus, you are Lord," it registers in my own heart and mind. So we speak to the world prophetically, and we speak to ourselves to remind ourselves always about who Jesus is and how we desire to serve him. "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord." So part of praise is praising him according to his name. Now we've talked about praying and interceding, that we pray in the name of the Lord. That means that we don't just tack on "in Jesus' name" at the end of our prayers. No, it means that we determine, as we study the word of God, we determine who is Jesus. What is he about? And then we pray our prayers, lining up our prayers with his character. I'm going to pray according to the person of Jesus. I'm going to praise according to the person of Jesus. I have done before and probably will do so again. The Lord gives me life and breath. Done studies on the names of God. What a great study, friends. Study the scriptures. What are the names of God in the Old Testament, in the New Testament? We pray according to his person, his character. Okay? There's power there. Talks about peace in heaven, right? And that word is translating for us the Hebrew word shalom, irene, the Greek word peace. It's translating for us the word shalom. It's more than just a cessation of hostilities, but it's health and wholeness and soundness and goodness. So as we praise, we are entering into kingdom realities that are present here and yet to come in a fuller way. When we praise, the veil between heaven and earth is removed, and we come literally into God's presence, his transformative presence. Friends, if you truly worship, if you truly praise, you're going to be a different person from when you began that process of praise. By nature, if you come into the presence of the Almighty, you will be changed. Because that's our God. That's his power. Right? Moses comes into the presence of God. We studied this recently, Corinthians 3, right? He comes into his presence, and when he walks away, what happens? He's glowing. He's glowing because of the holiness of God transforms his life, even physically, physiologically. He's changed. By being in the presence of holiness, God's holiness. So we embrace God, who is ruler of all. We praise him according to his character. We enter in to the heavenly realms, even while we are rooted physically here in this place, in this moment, that we enter in spiritually to the heavenly realms. P. peace in heaven and what? And glory. How many times do we circle back to the glory principle? All the time, because it's all over the scriptures. It's about God and the bigness and greatness of our God. It's about Him. Again, it's not about you, friend. You don't own your life. You don't get to decide what you do and how you do it and where you go and when it happens. No, it's all about Him. It's about the mightiness of our King. And He's a good King, isn't He, friends? He's a good King. It's about Him. Pharisees say, oh, no, we can't have any of the... Well, if these people don't do it, the very creation is going to cry out. Psalm 19 says it, that the creation speaks His glory. I'm not going to let the stones do my job. I'm going to do that glorifying. How I think, what I say, what I do. It's going to be about Him. So how do we make application of this? Okay? The Lord has need of it. The Lord needs you. My first point of application is critical to consider. And it's this, the Lord needs nothing. Wait a second, Pastor, you just titled your whole sermon, The Lord Needs You. And I did so with great intention. Because as we understand this first point of application, it makes in contrast my premise that the Lord needs us all the more amazing. Okay? The Lord needs nothing. Can I get an amen to that? All right, Paul, when he's in Athens and he's speaking to the godless Gentiles, he says this, the God who made the world and everything in it, being the Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man, nor is he served by human hands as though he, what? Needed anything. Think about it. Does God need anything? Is He lacking in any way, shape, or form? No. No. He needs nothing. Because He's God. That's part of being God. He needs nothing. Friends, think about this for a moment. You may not agree with me. But I believe Jesus could have said to the disciples that first Palm Sunday, just stand back and give me a little room. Because I'm going to float into Jerusalem. I'm going to levitate about 3 feet off of the ground. Along the path of the road towards the temple. Now we know after the resurrection, Jesus passes through doors and walls, right? Right? Do you remember that in the gospel stories? So we might think, well, Jesus needs to wait until after resurrection to do that kind of thing. Excuse me, didn't He walk on water before the resurrection? Did I hear a yes out there? Did Jesus walk on water? I believe Jesus could have floated into Jerusalem. Now, would that have been cool? Come on! I would have liked to see that. Can you imagine Him? Just, I think like 3 feet would have been really just like the right height. Not too high, not too low. Not moving His feet, just floating in to Jerusalem. He tells the disciples, if anybody asks you about taking this colt, tell them the Lord has need of it. He didn't really need the donkey, right? But Jesus, he constrained himself to the will of the Father, and the will of the Father had been expressed hundreds of years before in the prophet Zechariah, when the prophet said that Messiah would come to Israel, what? On a donkey, on the foal of a donkey, on a colt. So Jesus, I think, could have floated in Jerusalem, but in honoring the Father's wishes, he rides a donkey. So in that sense, he needed the donkey, right? He didn't need the donkey, but he needed the donkey. So the first point of application is this, is that God needs nothing. God needs nothing, okay? I speak out of both sides of my mouth, and I do so with great pride at this moment. God needs nothing, but the Lord needs you. Now catch this, friends, is that God has sovereignly chosen to constrain himself. I'm thinking about reaching the world for Jesus. Does the Father need us to do that? I don't believe so. I believe that today, right now, the Father could have Jesus appear to every single person alive on the planet simultaneously. And it would be Jesus, okay? Not a vision, not a dream. I believe Jesus could appear with his resurrected body to every single person. God has sovereignly constrained himself. I think that God brings dreams and visions to people at times of Jesus. So we've heard stories in terms of lost folk who've been visited. God has sovereignly chosen to constrain himself. He wants lost people found. The first core value of the Alliance, first of our core values as a movement, as a group, is that God loves lost people and he wants them found. But he's constrained himself that he has chosen that he wants to use us. Instead of going directly to every living person on the planet, he is not going to do that because he wants to use us. So God doesn't need us, point number one. And in the same token, he wonderfully, amazingly needs us. And this decision of God gives us purpose and meaning in life. Back to the glory principle, it's all about him. It's not about me, my wants, my desires, my wishes. It's about God. Every day I wake up, I need to be asking the question, God, what is it that you want today? Because it's about you, not about me. We gotta ask that question, friends. It's about the Almighty. It's about our loving Father, our Abba in heaven. It's about our Savior, Jesus, who went to the cross on our behalf. It's about him. So we need to find our place in his plan. God has sovereignly constrained himself. He is not going to directly reach the people of the world for Christ. He wants us to do that. And what is your role? Friend, you have a role. Do you understand you have a place in his plan? That God desires to use you to reach family and friends and neighbors and coworkers. You have an important job to play. So ask him. I believe he's going to tell you, right? God doesn't call us to something and then just hide the answer so we have to suffer and scramble. And there's work involved. I absolutely agree. I've experienced it myself in terms of persevering in prayer that sometimes the answer doesn't come the very first time we ask, because God relationally wants us in that place of surrender, being on our knees seeking him. But I believe God is a good God, and he delights in revealing to us his will. Jesus promised, "My sheep will know my voice. My sheep will know my voice." So ask him. Friends, if you've been a part of the fellowship for a while, I want to challenge you. Look back at your gift assessment that we did last year together. Right? What is it that was identified as part of your role in his big plan? And embrace that. Work in that. Right? So again, if you weren't part of the fellowship prior, that we went through a whole series on the gifts, and then at the end, I encourage folk to, you can either do it on your phone or your laptop. On your laptop, it's at placeministries.org, and you can do this spiritual assessment. It's over here, tells you about it here. Again, you can go to the App Store in terms of Apple or Android, and you can get it on your phone. But ask the Lord, what is it? What is my place? What is my role? And he will tell you. So in conclusion, I believe that Uncle Sam was recruiting for a war effort. But Jesus, friend, is doing the self-same thing. We are in a war, right? There's a spiritual war waging all around us. And Jesus wants us in his army. Okay? He wants you. Again, think of that great photo or cartoon or picture of Uncle Sam. I want you. Jesus is saying that to you today, friends. Jesus wants you in his army. I want to think about communion now as we kind of turn a page from our study of the scripture to the rest of the service. The old adage is, you are what you eat, right? The bread represents Jesus' body. The cup represents Jesus' blood. So we're eating and drinking Jesus. If you are what you eat, if you're eating and drinking Jesus, Jesus was a servant, right? I have not come to be served, but to serve and give my life as a ransom for many. Jesus is a servant. He came to serve the Father, to serve us by serving the Father. So if we eat and drink of Jesus, you are what you eat, we are. By default, kind of become servants. So friends, think about that today as we come to the communion table. How are you presently serving God? How might you serve God in a greater and deeper way in the week ahead? So we're going to close with communion. Just this incredible drama of remembrance and memorial that we remember, and we glorify God as we do remember. And then after communion, we're going to receive the palms. And for me, that action of taking the palms in hand and waving them as we praise is all about the kingly rule of Christ over our lives. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. King of kings, Lord of lords, Jesus, that's who you are. So we embrace Jesus in the communion meal, and we embrace Jesus in the palms. Quiet your hearts for a moment. Think about what I've shared. I'd like to invite you to come forward and receive the communion elements first. We'll do that and have communion, and then I'll invite you back to come for the palms. So if maybe one from each family or couple can come and get enough communion elements for those who need served, come and grab communion now. Thank you. The Gospels tell us that Jesus greatly desired to celebrate Passover with his closest friends, and he gathered them in an upper room in Jerusalem, and he went through the Seder with them, the Passover meal. And it says that after supper, Jesus took bread, and he broke it. Giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This is my body given for you." For those who recall being at Passover here in the past, the prayer that I believe Jesus would have prayed in terms of giving thanks for the bread is this: Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam hamotzi lechem min haaretz, which means, "Blessed art thou, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth." Blessed are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe. Inherent in the communion meal is a recognition of the kingly rule of the Almighty over our lives. When we eat the bread, having blessed it as Jesus would have blessed it, we are taking into ourselves the kingly rule of Jesus. Blessed art thou, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, the cosmos, to the farthest ends. We don't even know how big the universe is. Jesus is Lord over all of it, every square inch of it. He is ruler over. And so we take the bread with grateful hearts. We are what we eat. Jesus the servant king. Father, thank you so much for the bread and all that it means to us. And as we eat with joy, Lord, as we take it now, may Jesus be knit into us afresh and anew by your Holy Spirit power. God, would you form and fashion Christ in us in a greater and deeper way. We love you and we honor you, Father, in the eating of the bread. Let us eat together. The Gospels also recount for us that it was after supper that Jesus took a cup. That cup is identified in the Seder order as the cup of redemption. The cup of redemption. It says Jesus gave thanks over the cup and then gave it to his disciples saying, "This is the new covenant in my blood." The blessing I believe Jesus gave over that cup is this. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, borei pri hagafen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God. Again, listen, friends, listen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. When we drink this cup, friends, we are drinking deeply of the kingly rule of Jesus over our lives. That's what this cup is. Embedded in the communion meal is the lordship of Jesus over all. You are what you eat. You are what you drink. We're drinking his reign over R-E-I-G-N, not R-A-N. Reign of the Holy Spirit, R-A-I-N. We like that. But the reign, the rule, the authority of Christ. Father, thank you for the cup and all that it means to us now, Lord. And we drink deeply. We imbibe, Lord, the reality that Jesus is our King. He's Lord and Master of our lives. Let it be so. We say yea and amen by your Spirit's power working in us that he would truly rule over us today. To your glory and honor, Lord Jesus, we drink. In memory of your shed blood, we love you, Lord Christ. We love you, Lord Jesus. We love you, Master. Let's drink now. Bill Tudor, if you'd kindly step up to this side of the palms, and Jim, if you'd come over here. If you don't mind moving out of your rows as you come forward, and as many can do it on their own, I would encourage you to come grab your own palms, but move out of your rows towards the back of the building, and then circle around, and let's come and grab our palms now. And if the worship team would get into place as we begin this process and begin singing as soon as you guys are ready. Okay, thank you.
Song. Hosanna. our hearts to you, Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise you, God. Praise you, Lord. Oh. Father, thank you so much, God, for the opportunity to be in your house today, Lord. We know that you dwell not in temples made by human hands. But God, you have made each of us, and we are a living temple, Lord, to you. Would you fill us as a temple, Lord, both individually and corporately as a body? Fill us to overflowing. God, as we have time of fellowship, and then as we head home, Lord, would you go before us, surround us, Lord, with your Spirit's power, that we might be praisers of Jesus, that we would not allow the rocks and stones to take our job, or that we would do what you created us to do, that we would be worshipers of yours, Lord. And that we would honor Jesus by what we think, say, and do. Lord, bless the week ahead. Lord, as we rehearse in our hearts and minds the events of this week, Lord, the mock trial of Jesus, Lord, the brutal beating by the guards, Lord, and ultimately, as we think about Jesus going to the cross for our sake, as we think of the Passover of God, how the blood on the door, the lintel, and the posts, Lord, how it covered your people, and the angel of death passed them by because of the blood. And Lord, we know that in Jesus, the angel of death has to pass us by because of the blood of Christ. So Lord, as we think about Resurrection Sunday, a week from today, Lord, as we think of all that Jesus did for us in these 7 days ahead, Lord, and how he rose up and conquered death and hell, Lord, that we would walk every day this week ahead, every day we would walk in resurrection power. Pour out your Spirit, Lord, fresh and anew on us. We thank you, Lord, for the communion meal and all that it means for us to have shared that together, Lord, in your presence. Lord, bless us as we go. Use us, Lord, as your witnesses that you don't need anything, but you have sovereignly chosen to need us, to do the job, Lord, to do the task, Lord, of the Great Commission, to make the name of Jesus great in this place here and to the ends of the earth, Lord. That's our job, to be your witnesses and your ambassadors. So send us forth with power, Holy Ghost fire in our bellies, Lord, that we would burn brightly for Jesus. Send us out, Lord, to be your hands and feet, Lord. We love you, and we thank you, and we praise you now, Father, in Jesus' holy name, amen. God bless you as you go, friends.
Thank you, Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna.